Feminist Creativist presents a word for every generation that knows no fashion.
Greetings. I hope and trust I find you well. We are continuing from this series, When Your Own Do Not Believe in You. Two, for this morning, every challenge prepares you for the future. Some of us, we need an Eliab so that we are psyched up for the next unbeliever. We need to have someone who will not believe in us, not to break us, but to motivate us. Come with me to the book of 1 Samuel. We're still in chapter 17, and we continue reading from verse number 32. The Bible reads as follows. David said to Saul, "Don't let anyone be discouraged by him. Your servant will go and fight this Philistine." But Saul replied, "You can't go fight this Philistine. You are just a youth, and he's been a warrior since he was young." Verse 34, David answered Saul, "Your servant has been tending his father's sheep. Whenever a lion or bear came and carried off a lamb from the flock, I went after it, struck it down, and rescued the lamb from its mouth. If it reared up against me, I would grab it by its fur, strike it down, and kill it. Your servant has killed lions and bears. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, for he has defied the armies of the living God." Then David said, "The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine." So say to David, "Go, and may the Lord be with you." Before I say go and may the Lord be with you, why don't we talk to him in prayer? Kind and gracious Father in the heavens above, thank you, dear Lord, for the privilege of appearing before kings and queens so that we may testify that the Lord has been with us. Testify that the Lord will see us through. As we start this week, we pray, dear Lord, that you may deliver us from the paws of the lions, deliver us from the paws of the bears, and deliver us from the human paws of our modern Philistines. This has been our prayer of faith. In Jesus' name we pray and we ask, amen. My dear friends, come with me once again, and we want to raise 5 points before we go our separate ways. Notice as David speaks to Saul, he has been called into the presence of the king, and at every moment he identifies himself as thy servant, thy servant, thy servant. Why does he identify himself as thy servant? Because remember, as you go back into the earlier chapters, I think it should be beginning of chapter 16, you realize that David has already been anointed as the king of Israel. So he is basically the king in waiting. We usually refer to this as the president in waiting. As the king in waiting, he still identifies himself as thy servant. Before we take on some of these jobs, we need to master the challenge of servanthood. Some of us cannot humble ourselves to a servant position. This is the first challenge that David has received, and he has aced it. He is already anointed king, but he is willing to go out and pasture after the sheep. That is servanthood. And this is something that we need to learn. At point number two, the second challenge. Before you meet the Goliaths of your life, God will have you take on lions, take on bears in order to build your confidence in him. With God, we start great and we end small. With human effort, we scratch small and we end up great. God does not want you to face, Goliath, but he takes you to a lion first. He then takes you to a bear first, and then he ends with a human being. By the time you get to a human being, your confidence levels are so high. You know where God has seen you through. You know how far God has led you. And like Samuel, you can place an Ebenezer stone and say, "Thus far, the Lord has been with me." What has God been making you face, my dear friends? As you are facing the lions of your life, as you are facing the bears of your life, Some of you have very difficult supervisors. Guess what? The Lord is preparing you for another supervisor who's going to turn out like a walk in the park. Some of you have difficult subordinates, and God is preparing you for the time you run your own company, and you are going to have a very difficult person to deal with. God gives us all these challenges. They are about just preparation. They are preparatory. And just before he walks in, remember, Eliab has just told him, you're arrogant, you're evil. What have you come here for? But you see the battle, go back and take care of those few little sheep. But he is brought in before Saul. Saul says, you are inexperienced. You are too young. This man has been fighting from the day of his youth. While he extols the Philistine, he fails to believe in David. Because Eliab has already told him, I do not believe in you, the young man's ego cannot be wounded any further. His own family cannot believe in him. What? Why should he expect anything different when he gets to Saul? So he is already charged, regardless of what Saul is going to say. Point number three, there is also something I want us to take note. There are two other lessons, challenges that David faces. Number one, he has to rescue the lamb without killing the trespasser. He says, every time the animal snatched the lamb, I went and recovered my lamb from its mouth. From its mouth. This was a daunting task, but here was the other thing. After this particular lamb had been snatched, he just retrieved the lamb from the mouth, but he did nothing to the thief. He did nothing to the snatcher. This was a challenge. This was a challenge. What was the challenge? When it is in your power to do wrong, when it is in your power to do more and be excessive, when you have been wronged by this particular lion that has grabbed your animal, this bear that has grabbed your lamb, all you do is go back and recover the lamb. You do not engage the lion. You do not fight the lion. You do not kill it. What is the challenge? Every challenge that those who are in power face, it is the challenge of restraint. When it is in your power to act, are you going to exercise restraint? And David was taught this. Where? Right there. With the little few sheep in the wilderness, Eliab could not learn this lesson. The lesson of restraint when it is in your power to act. When did David go on to act? Notice at point number 3b, to kill only when the trespasser threatens your life. David only kills in self-defense. He never becomes an aggressor. How many of us in positions of authority go on a militative, a confrontational stance, and we are not being defensive? Many a time we are on the offensive. But David had this challenge ahead of time. And at point number 4, he says, to defy the armies of the living God. God is threatened. And their existence in the whole world is something that should be protected by the king. But the king will not raise his finger. The king will do absolutely nothing. So the king in waiting has to do the job. The king in waiting, David. So God does not allow us to have a vacuum. Saul has already been set aside. The Lord is no longer with Saul. He has anointed another. The Lord will not allow us to remain without leadership. There will always be a king on the seat. The Lord remains seated at all times and is in control. The million-dollar question is, while Saul does not believe in David, he goes on to say, may the Lord go with you. It makes no difference. It makes no difference how others choose to bless us in spite of not believing it. The Lord is with us all the same. As we go out, even if they do not believe in you, remember this challenge. Remember this challenge. Whether they believe you or not, God will rescue you all the same. God will be with you and God will go with you. May the God of Israel go with you. Until we meet again next Monday, may the good Lord bless and keep you. Amen.